came the morning that sealed the promise.
Now I'm going to go off of it, Uriel. How about now, guys?
Is there sound now? Because I took it off the.
I took it off.
So how's the sound? Oh, Uriel's telling me the sound is good now. Okay. Yes. Okay, well this is, yeah. Okay, well what we're doing is this is ambience. I'm not coming through the speakers anymore. I'm just doing the iPad, but it should be loud enough. I mean, my face is 6 inches from it. And Pastor Rick's gonna be on a microphone, so you should all be able to hear. All right. We're fine. Everybody's been filmed and we've been live for 11 minutes.
Well, I knew that. I asked Uriel to, just in case people came on, they could see people.
Yes.
Walking around and hanging out and stuff. Sorry, yeah. I have to do this in front of everybody. That's not good, huh? Everybody's bringing up their stuff early. That's good.
Well, church is starting, but not exactly started until.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Somebody sings.
Turn this on. Oh, it's so nice to see all of you in church today. Good morning. Have you been talking to each other and saying hello and all that good stuff? Well, no, nobody's talking. Everybody just quit talking.
Well, I'm far enough away from everybody. I'm going to take this off because it sounds a little better probably, huh? A little muted before. I will have to tell you this. We are in the most blessed place on the planet this morning, so thank you for being here. It's fun to worship with you. I had so much fun worshiping with you yesterday, or last week, I guess. It feels like yesterday. And so I'm glad you're here with us this morning. God has great things for us. I am so looking forward to our conversation today. I almost just want to start it right now. I think it's going to be so much fun. But we're going to wait and start it when we after we worship the Lord together. So listen, I just want you to turn to each other. I know you're kind of socially distanced the way you're supposed to be. But wave to each other and say hello and good morning. And we have people back in the desert again that were gone for a while. So we welcome back. We're glad you're here. That's awesome. I'm going to try to stand in this one spot, Billy, so you don't have to move around very much today, if that helps you. Does it or not?
We're off the mic, and Walter said, I'm too far away from you.
Oh, Walter.
So I'm asking, yeah, and which I am too far away from.
Okay, well, we're going to figure this out, and that's cool. So anyway, let's pray. Thank you, Father, for this morning. We thank you for the ability to be here together today. We thank you that our church is open and people are here and we're worshiping together. And this is going to be so much fun. Thank you for Brian being able to put something up for us so that we might be able to worship together. We thank you for that, Lord Jesus. And more than anything else, God, I pray today that we learn how to love you well. I pray today, Lord God, that as we come together, the thing on our heart and the thing on our mind is that you are our God and we are your people. And we're coming to this place, Lord Jesus, to celebrate together as your people. Let this be an action of love as we raise our voices to you today. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Morning, boys. Have a seat. Right up here, you're going to see You're going to see that come on.
Hey, church, I hope you're doing well today as you're coming in for worship. We're going to do some singing in just a moment, and we're going to praise the Lord today. We're going to praise Him because churches are open up now and people can gather for worship. We're going to praise Him because He's been taking care of our needs. We're going to praise Him because He's in control. He is sovereign. We're going to praise Him for never giving up on us. And even when we don't deserve His grace, He never gives up on us. We're going to praise Him for redeeming our lives. Psalm 103 says it this way. This is King David wrote this. It says, "Praise the Lord, my soul. All my inmost being, praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases. Who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with love and compassion. Who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles." So let's bring our praise to the Lord this morning. Father, thank you so much that you're in control, that we can trust you. Today as we gather in worship, we lift up your name and we praise you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship together. All right, church, good morning. Let's put our hands together and worship the Lord.
Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. Bear my
Hallelujah.
Just listen to you sing. Thank you so much for worshiping the Lord and praising Him. It's such an awesome, awesome thing to hear your voices all raised in concert together as this wonderful one voice praising the Lord. God says He inhabits the praises of His people. So guess what? Here and there are many other places today, at this very moment, God is presenting Himself in a very special way to those of us who have lifted Him up and praised Him. So this is a wonderful day. Well, I'm excited about being here. Anybody else happy about being here? Yeah, good. Woo. Kathy, how are you feeling today? Way better? Yeah, good. Good. Do we need to pray for you some more? No, you're okay? All right. No.
Pray for me anytime you want.
Pray for you anytime you want. Well, we will. Thank you very much for that opportunity. Last week, Kathy had a hurt rib. I don't know what was wrong with it, because I'm not. It was what?
I had a fracture.
She said she had a fractured rib. I think that's what you said, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So we prayed for her, and it's much better today. We're very thankful, because that's just very painful. If any of you had a back issue or a rib issue, you know how tough that is. That's not a fun thing. You slept last night? Well, good. That's why you're a happy girl today. That's awesome. Anyway, sleep's always helpful, right? So today we need to pray. So if there's anything on your heart, mind, or soul that you want us to pray about today, you want to share some of that. You know, we haven't been able to be together for a while. So if there's a prayer request that you have for us, let's go to the Lord in prayer today. If you have a prayer request that you want us to pray for, just stand up and just represent that prayer. We'll pray for you. Anybody? Okay. Anyone else? Anybody else with a prayer request? Oh, there's probably lots of them all around with people going through stuff. Amen. Look at that. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Just stay there. Father, we thank you so much for these people that are here, that are standing today. We thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit's presence in this place. We thank you that your word tells us. We don't have to guess. Your word says to us, and we believe your word, that you inhabit the praises of your people. You come and live in the praises of your people. And so, Father, we know that you're here. We said, when two or three are gathered together. But, Lord, we know that your Holy Spirit takes residence within us personally if we're believers. So we know without doubt, we know that we know that we know that you're in this place. And so, Father, I thank you for every one of these people who are standing. Father, I pray for a touch on their life. I pray that you would minister to them. Father, for those who are sick, I pray that you would be with them. For those who need family issues, relationship issues, for those who need financial issues, for every issue, Father, that needs to be dealt with today, with these people that are standing up, and say, God, I need your touch. With their courage, Lord Jesus, to stand up, I pray that you would reach down even now and that you would touch them, that there would be a touch of the Holy Spirit's presence, a touch of Jesus on their life, and you would take care of whatever need they have. Lord God, we are so grateful that we can come to you and ask you to help us with all the things of our life. Thank you, Father, for ministering in a very special way. And today, we're reminded today, Lord Jesus, to pray for our president and his sweet wife. We pray, Father, that you would minister to them, that I know there are millions of people praying for them. And I thank you so much for his quick recovery. We pray that it would continue. We pray that the First Lady's recovery would continue. We pray that you would take care of them and minister to them. All those other people who were ill because of that contact, Father, we pray that they would be well in Jesus' name. And I think, I don't know why, just Chris Christie this morning was on my heart. I pray for him. I thank you for ministering to him. Thank you, God, for taking care. We pray that you would keep us safe in this place as well. We love you, Jesus. We praise you. We thank you for letting us be here. In Jesus' holy and precious name, and his church said, amen, 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 amen. You may be seated. I wish we could do things more normally. I wish you could get up and hug each other. But, you know, we really didn't start at 10:10. We started at 10 o'clock, and somebody put it online that we started at 10:10 because I confused everybody. It's my fault. But what I want us to know is that at 10 o'clock, church begins at Las Palmas Community Church. What we want you to know, though, is that because we have people online, lots of people online right now, what we want you to know, and hi, how are you? Everybody say hi to those online. Say really loud. If you could see them waving, that would be cool. But anyway, they're all waving. I know the camera's pointed here, but trust me, they're all waving. So anyway, but we want you that are here to be able to socially distance and say hello to one another. And so we want to give you an opportunity to do that. Why? Because we've missed each other for such a long time. We haven't been around each other. How you doing, boys? Man, I miss you. I haven't seen you. You're looking good. I like your cat. It's good. All right. So anyway, I just am thankful to be here. One of the things that we get to do when we're here is we get to give an offering. But I look at these plates, and I've been watching people all morning bring stuff up. So if you have an offering or if you brought a tithe today, I'm going to ask that you come and bring it down. And why do we give tithes and offerings? Listen, I want you to hear this because this is really important. We give tithes and offerings because they're a part of who we are as the body of Christ that says this. It says, Lord, here we are. We give you our life. We give it to you, and we want you to take it. So a tithe and offering is not so much about dollars and cents. A tithe and offering is way more about, Lord, here's my life. I give it to you. So as you come and give your offering today, thank you so much. As you come and give your offering today, give your life back to Christ. That's what offering is all about. Amen? Amen. All right. Thank you, sir. Watch out with that sucker in your mouth. Don't fall. That's, you got another job, huh? All right. Well, today we're going to go backwards. Today we're going to go back to a portion of scripture that Billy and I had a chance to go over, but I want us to do it. I want us to give it a little more attention. And it's the conversation that's found in three different places in the Bible, and we'll go to those three different places. But it's a conversation that says that someone came to Jesus, I think in a very honest and sincere way, came to Jesus and asked him this question, what is the greatest commandment? I don't think that they were trying to test him at that point. They'd already tried to do that, and they couldn't do it. And they couldn't trick Jesus. They couldn't make him say things that he, you know, shouldn't say. And so, you know, they, it comes to a place where one person who's sincere, I believe, comes and says, what's the greatest commandment? Now, maybe they were trying to trick him. I don't know. But in some of the scriptures, it doesn't say that. Some of them, it does. So, anyway, let's go and look at that. Can you put that up? I was giving you an opportunity. Thank you. Let's go to Matthew, the one in Matthew first. Matthew 22. Okay, right here. Can you go up just in, right before that so we can put it into context? Okay, all the way to a little more, 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 a little more. All right, okay. There's a discussion about the resurrection and angels. Now, why is there a discussion about the resurrection and angels? It says, that same day, Jesus was approached by some Sadducees. Well, the Sadducees are people who don't believe in the resurrection, and they don't believe in the angels, and because they don't believe in the resurrection, and because they don't believe in the angels, they come and try to trick Jesus. So they're really trying to grab him into a place, they're trying to put him into a place where they put him in the middle of all these Jewish people, some alike and some won't. So they're trying to really destroy his reputation. It's kind of like gotcha questions that you hear all the time asked of political leaders, or gotcha questions. And this is a, these are gotcha questions, right? So these are the Sadducees, these religious leaders say there's no resurrection from the dead. That's how, you know, we know that by history, but we also, because it says it right here, right? The Sadducees don't believe in the resurrection. They pose this question, verse 24. Teacher Moses said, can you go up, please? Teacher Moses said, if you die, then wait, there you go. If you die without children, his brother should marry the widow and have a child who will carry on the brother's name. So you get this, right? There's a couple, they weren't able to have children yet, he passes away, but because he's been married to his brother, the brother's supposed to take her as his wife. They're supposed to have children so his name can be carried on, right? So there's still a part of that genealogy that happened. So anyway, this is what's going on. Should marry and have a child who will carry on the brother's name. Well, suppose there are seven brothers. When the oldest one married, can you please keep going up for it? I know that's the oldest one married and then died without children. So his brother married the widow. But the second brother also died, and the third brother married her. This continued with all seven of them. Last of all, the woman also died. Tell us, whose wife will she be in the resurrection? For all seven were married to her. So first of all, they don't believe in the resurrection. So for them to ask a question about the resurrection is just crazy. It just doesn't even make any sense. We're not going to go back into this because we studied this. I want to go into this conversation about the greatest commandment, but I want to set it up for you. So this is Jesus' answer, verse 29. It says this. Jesus replied, your mistake is that you don't know the scriptures. So I want you to see that. As the church, I want you to see that. Our mistake, when we make mistakes in philosophies of life and when we make mistakes in understanding of life, we make mistakes because we don't understand scripture. We don't, you know, these people were supposed to be the teachers. These people were supposed to be the ones who showed everyone what the scripture meant. These were the pastoral leadership of the Jewish nation. These guys were supposed to, they were the lawyers. They studied it. They understood it. They were supposed to have it down. And Jesus said, listen, the problem that you guys have is that look right here. It says, your mistake is that you don't know the scriptures. And you don't know the power of God. So there's two things you don't know. There's two things that you must know if you're going to do what Jesus says are the greatest commandments. And these are the two things that you have to know. That's why I want to come back here. You have to know the scriptures about what we're going to talk about when it comes to loving your neighbor and loving God. You have to know the scriptures. And you have to know the power of God. You have to have those two things in your life. If you don't have those two things in your life, if you don't understand the scriptures, and if you don't understand the power of God, it's going to be very difficult for you to live what God's going to tell you to live in a few moments. Do you understand that? The power of God, the authority that you have in God is so important. We've been talking about that in this church for years now, a couple years probably. The authority that you have, you need to understand that you as a believer in Christ, we as believers in Christ, we have an authority that comes to us from the power of God, and it belongs to us because it's been given to us so that we can use it to exercise what God asks us to exercise in our lives. He's got something very specific for you to do, and he wants you to do it, but he wants you to know that you have the power and you have the scripture to know what it is that you're to do, and he wants you to have that in your understanding. You need to understand the word of God. It's really important. Now I'm not going to just belabor that anymore, but I want you to grasp that before we go to the next conversation. Now watch this. For when the dead rise, so Jesus is saying, you don't believe in the resurrection, but Jesus is saying there's going to be a resurrection. For when the dead rise, they will neither marry nor be given in marriage. In this respect, they will be like the angels in heaven. So they don't believe in angels, and they don't believe in the resurrection. And Jesus is saying to them, listen, you've got a problem. The problem is you don't know your scriptures, and if you did know your scriptures, you don't know the power behind the scriptures. You don't even know God himself. That's what he's saying. You have to get a grasp of that. You have to have an understanding of who God is. That's important when it comes to the next conversation. I'll show you in a second. Watch this. But now, as to whether there will be a resurrection of the dead, haven't you ever read about this in the scriptures? Listen, what he's saying is, don't you read your Bible? He could ask that question of the church, couldn't he? Don't you ever read your Bible? Right?
Haven't you ever read, and he's talking about the Old Testament, I understand that, right? But haven't you ever read about this in the scriptures? Long after Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had died, God said, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. So he is the God of the living, not the dead. He's saying, these people, Abraham, Isaac, he's saying, look, these guys are alive. And how could they be alive if there's no resurrection of the dead? Don't you know your Bible? Get to know your Bible. Now watch. Go up, please. Verse 33 all the way. Thank you. When the crowds heard him, they were astonished at his teaching. What were they astonished at his teaching? Why were they astonished at his teaching? Because he had authority, because he had the power of God behind him. He understood the power, and he knew the word. How did he know the word? He wrote it. Right? He wrote it. Let me tell you how powerful the word is. When Jesus was beginning his ministry, Satan led him, or the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the desert to be tempted by Satan. What did Satan use? What did Satan use to tempt Jesus? The word of God. There's nothing more powerful than the word of God. And if Satan will use the word of God, how does he do it? He takes it and he twists it just slightly so it sounds right, but it's not right. And anytime you twist the word of God, you've now stepped over the line into wickedness. So be careful about the word of God. And I want you to see Adam and Eve, right? What did Satan do with Eve? He twisted God's word. And when he twisted God's word, he stepped over the line into wickedness. So Jesus says you have to understand the scripture. It's important. Not just read it, but study it. Now that's really important, and we're going to unpack some things in a second. So watch this. But can you go all the way up to 34? But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees with his reply, they met together to question him again. One of them, an expert in the religious law, tried to trap him with this question, teacher, which is the most important commandment in the law of Moses. Now, it says that they tried to trap him here again, but I kind of think this guy had some sincerity in his life about asking this question. So this is what he's trying to do here with this question. This is important. I want you to get this. Yes, they're trying to trap him. I think he's a little sincere because of what happens. But this is, look at, watch this. What are they trying to do with Jesus? There are 613 laws that the Jewish nation had amassed for itself. And if you were going to be a believer in God, Yahweh, the Old Testament, if you're going to be a believer in God, who's our God, if you're going to be a believer in God, you would have to make sure that you did all those 613 laws, not just the Ten Commandments. And when you did those 613 laws, and if you could make sure that your life lined up with all of them all the time, then you would be okay with God. Well, that's just impossible. Can't do it. So what they were trying to do, what was happening here, is they knew how important the law was, but they knew no one could take, they knew no one could live up to the law, but they knew how important it was. And what they were trying to do is they were trying to get Jesus to say, this law, because he said, what's the one great out of all these laws? What's the one great law? And if he just chose one, what would he do? He would separate all the other laws from that one law. And remember, all of them are important. So if you took one out, they would say, what about all these? How come you don't like these? And they would start hammering it all. But Jesus is brilliant. Jesus knows motives, and he knows exactly what they're trying to do, and he knows how to answer them in such a way that they can't answer him back. It always happens. He's brilliant. Now, I want you to understand what that means. That means this. That means whenever there's a question in your life, Jesus is brilliant with his answer to you. He didn't stop being brilliant there. He didn't stop giving the best answers on the planet in the Bible. He continues to give you the best answers on the planet through his word to you. So you still have them. Now watch this. We're going to get to something real quick in a second. Okay. Jesus replied, verse 37. You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind.
some of the scriptures say, with all your strength, I think that's a really much better conversation. I'll tell you why. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. And the entire law and all the commandment, all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. So what he's saying is this. This is what you have to do. You have to learn in your life to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. All your mind and with all your strength added. There are two other places in the Synoptic Gospel, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. There are two other places that this story is told, and Jesus gives the greatest commandment. And so when you go to those other two places, you start to glean some things. But what I wanted to do is I wanted to camp on this conversation for a while. I wanted us to go here for a few minutes, and I wanted us to see something about this. Because if this is the most important thing, and that's what Jesus is saying, isn't it? He's saying, the most important thing isn't if you're going to be resurrected and all this stuff. That's not the most important thing for you as a believer in Christ is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And I'm not sure we understand what that means. I'm not sure when I start thinking about this, I'm not sure we get it when it comes to the conversation about, first of all, what is love? Well, you know, the first thing we do is go to the love chapter. Love is patient. Love is kind. 1 Corinthians 13, right? All this stuff about that keeps no record of wrongs. Love's a wonderful thing. Okay, what is love? I want you to catch something here that's really important. I want you to catch the mindset that Jesus is speaking to. I want you to understand how they understood this word. This word is agape, but I want you to know it only appears, there's a thing called the Septuagint. You know what the Septuagint is? Some of you do, some of us don't. The Septuagint is the entire Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, that was written in Greek. It was translated into Greek. The Old Testament was originally written in Hebrew and Aramaic, but Hebrew mostly. So they translated it from Hebrew into Greek. The word agape is a Greek word. Before we understood the word agape in the New Testament, it was barely used in the Old Testament. The Old Testament talked about love all the time, but it didn't use this word agape love. It used the Old Testament talks about love, but it uses all kinds of different words. It doesn't use this one. It's only found 13 times when it's translated from Hebrew to Greek. It's only found 13 times in the Old Testament. So it's not there. The reason I say it's only found when it's translated, remember, because it was translated from Hebrew to Greek. The New Testament is written in Greek. So when they translated the Old Testament into Greek, that word agape is only discovered 13 times in the entire New Old Testament. So when that word is only used 13 times, it's not a very important word in the Old Testament. Love is used many times, much more than, but it's not that one word they translated agape. So why is that word so important? The Hebrew word is chava, and it means to have affection for, to desire, to delight in, or to be fond of. It implies an inherent inclination of the mind and of a tenderness of affection. And it denotes a strong, now I'm going to read this to you, but I'm not going to talk about it. It denotes a strong emotional attachment for and desire to be in the presence of the object of love. That's why it's a word that really doesn't mean I have a feeling for you. There's an emotional connection, but it's not a feeling. It's different than that. That's why it's not translated only but 13 times as agape. Now, let me read to you something else. The Greek word agape, and this is important, I got to put on my glasses because this is small. This is from J.I. Packer, who is known as one of the two greatest living evangelical theologians in the world. And so this is, the word agape, love, seems to have been virtually a Christian invention, a new word for a new thing. Apart from about 20 or so occurrences in the Greek version of the Old Testament, well, I said 13, that's what I read, but he says 20. It is almost non-existent before the New Testament. Agape draws its meaning directly from the revelation of God in Christ. So listen to this, this is really important. When I say you have to understand the Bible, you have to understand this, because this will tell you what it means to love God, and I'm going to show you something.
And that's why we need to kind of understand some of this stuff. It is not a form of natural affection. It's not a form of, oh, I love her. You know when you first met your significant other? Oh, everything was happy. About 20 years later, you can't stand each other. Sometimes, right? You know what I mean, right? It's like a boy, maybe a girl guy, but I don't know, I'm never a girl. So it's like a boy who gets his first car. It doesn't matter what the car is, it's the greatest thing on the planet. Look, my first truck that I ever got was from my grandfather. It was a 1949 Chevy, but man, it was so awesome. My grandfather found it in the field and cleaned it up and gave it to me. And I drove it for about 3 weeks because it was dead in a doornail. I couldn't drive, but it was the greatest truck on the planet. My second truck was a 1949 Ford. I bought it for $50 from a guy out of a field, and I drove it home. It only lasted one ride from the farmer's field halfway to my house. And you know why it only lasted that far? Because I'm driving, and all of a sudden I see a tire going down the road. My front tire came off, and it starts going down the road. And I fell over, and that was it. And that was my $50 truck. I was a good salesman. I sold it for $25 and they picked it up. It was great. Greatest trucks on the planet. The most wonderful. I mean, I shined them up. I did everything before, you know. My grandpa's truck, man, that thing was the cleanest one because I love my truck. Right? You guys got it, right? It's like this. When you first get a brand new car, you have an affection for it. You love it. You keep it clean. About 6 weeks later, it's full of trash. Anybody do that? Come on, be honest. This word agape doesn't mean that kind of fleeting affection. This word agape means something more than that. Agape draws its meaning from the revelation of God in Christ, which means this: for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son. That's what love is. Love is not an emotion in this respect. Love is not an affection like, oh, you feel like you're going to puke when you're in love, you know, because you're everything's, you know, all messed up inside of you. You know what I mean? Love is not an affection. Love is an action. Love is an action. And when it says this, it is not a form of natural affection, however intense, but a supernatural fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22. What is the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. I know all of it, but love. It's an action. It's something that happens. It's something you do. It's a matter of the will. What's the will? The will is what I choose to do. So when it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, or your strength, and with all your strength, that strength tells you, with everything in me, I'm going to act as if I love God. No matter what anybody else says, no matter what the society is telling me, no matter what people don't like about me, I'm going to act with the love of God. I'm going to obey God with every strength of might I have. I'm going to obey God. That's what it means to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul. But not just with your strength. But again, this word agape is a supernatural, it's created by God. And it's because remember I said you had to know the scripture and you had to know the power of God? You can't love like this if you don't know the power of God in your life. The Bible says that we're supposed to place God in the context, loving God in the context of a command. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll obey my commandments, right? I read so many stories that I just began to get emotional about this. I know we're not talking about emotion, we're talking about action, but I just began to get emotional about this. One of the stories I read, I brought a bunch of them to read to you. I wish we could just read the stories I found about loving in action. She was lying on the ground. This is from a book. from Dick Hill called "The Love is a Costly Thing." She was lying on the ground. In her arms, she held a tiny baby girl. As I put a cooked sweet potato into her outstretched hands, I wondered if she would live until morning. Her strength was almost gone, but her tired eyes acknowledged my gift. The sweet potato could help so little, but it's all I had. Taking a bite, she chewed it carefully. Then, placing her mouth over the baby's mouth, she forced the soft, warm food into the tiny throat. Although the mother was starving, she used the entire potato to keep her baby alive. Exhausted from her effort, she dropped her head to the ground and closed her eyes. In a few minutes, the baby was fast asleep. I later learned that during the night, the mother's heart stopped, but the little baby lived. Love is a costly thing. God, in his love for us and for the lost world, spared not his own son to tell the world of his love. Love is costly, but we must tell the world at any cost. Such love is costly. It costs parents, sons and daughters, and spouses. It costs spouses. It cost the missionary life itself. In his love for Christ, the missionary most often gave up all to make the Savior known. If you will let your love of Christ cost you something, the great advance will be made together. We can understand that, right? When a mom loves a baby, we can get that kind of love. But what kind of love is it for Jesus? It's action. What kind of love is it for Jesus, who is God himself, who has everything? He doesn't need us. And he gives us everything. And he goes through a major, major passion week of abuse. And what is it that God would give up everything to come and say, "I love you, please. I love you. Know that I love you." What kind of love is that? That while we're his enemies, while we don't like him, while we curse him, and while we say all kinds of negative things about him, while we do all that, he loves us. He loves us. I read so many stories. I got another one in my head. But how we spoke, I'll give you one in a minute. But look at that. The Bible says that we're supposed to be those people who come with strength. And that we're supposed to love him with all of our heart, right? This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is it, love your neighbor as yourself. We'll talk about that in a minute if we have time. But look at this. You must love the Lord your God with all your heart. The heart is the center of your being. He must be more important to you. You must make a decision to make him more important to you than anything else on the planet. He is your God. You must love him with all your soul. What's your soul? Your soul is your mind, your emotion, and your will. Your emotion shouldn't rule your life, but a command of Jesus should rule your life. And I can just hear somebody say, "Well, yeah, Rick, but the Bible says that you become a Christian not by your works, lest any man should boast, but by faith." Yeah, you become a Christian. It's a free gift. That's what's called grace. But you become a Christian who loves God by obeying his commandments. You become a lover of God by doing something with your faith. That's what's important about this. Our heart is the center of our physical and our spiritual life. It encompasses all of our passions, all of our desires, all of our affections. According to the Vine's dictionary, listen, I want to give you heart. I want you to understand some of these words. Heart, I want to study the scripture with you today. Heart comes to stand for a man's entire mental and moral activity, both the rational and the emotional elements.
What does that mean? That means every choice that I make is about my heart. Every emotion that I feel is about my heart. Every decision I decide to do is about my heart. My heart. I'm supposed to love God with all of my heart. I'm supposed to love Him with all of my soul, with my mind, with my emotions, with my decisions, my will. And I'm supposed to love Him, and some of them say, with all our strength. Maybe we won't get there today, but with all your strength, which means everything in me is directed to love God by my action. How do you love God? How do you love Him? With your action. And some of you are going, well, that sounds really nice, but you know, that's okay. But this, you know, I found something I want to share this with you. This is a great story, if I can find it again. I don't know what I did with it. Oh, here it is. Newspaper columnist. I'll read this to you. This is really good. Newspaper columnist and minister George Crane tells of a wife. Now this is pretty applicable for COVID, because wives and husbands aren't getting along too good right now. Some of them are. Listen to this. It's a wife who came into his office full of hatred toward her husband. I mean, this wife hated her husband. I know people who hate their spouse. This is what she said, quote, "I do not only want to get rid of him, I want to get even. Before I divorce him, I want to hurt him as much as he has hurt me. I want to hurt him." Wow. She's got a great little attitude. Now watch this. Dr. Crane, he's a pastor and he's a talk show host. Dr. Crane suggests an ingenious plan. Quote, "Go home and act as if you really love your husband. Just act it. Tell him how much he means to you. Praise him for every decent trait he has. Go out of your way to be kind. As kind as you can, considerate and generous as possible. Go out of your way. Spare no effort to please him, to enjoy him. Make him believe you love him. You don't really, I know you hate him, but just make him believe that you might like him. Just be an actress. After you've convinced him of your undying love and that you cannot live without him, then drop the bomb. Really blow him up. Tell him that you're getting a divorce. That will really hurt him. It'll hurt him to the core." With revenge in her eyes, she smiled and explained, "Beautiful, beautiful. It'll be a great surprise." And she did it with enthusiasm, acting, quote, "as if," unquote. 2 months had gone by. She showed her love. She showed her kindness. She listened to him. She gave him what he wanted. She reinforced him in every way. She shared with him all the great traits. And then she didn't return to Dr. Crane's office. So Dr. Crane called her. "Are you ready to go through the divorce?" he says. "Divorce?" she exclaimed. "Never! I discovered I really love him." Her actions had changed her feelings. Motion resulted in emotion. The ability to love is established not so much by fervent promise as by repeated deeds. Man, what a great story. What a great story. See, if we can change the way we feel about a person that we hate, how much would our deeds toward God change the way we feel about Jesus? How much our deeds towards the Father? How much would we feel like we want to do something and God says, knocks on your door and says, no, 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 no. How much if we would listen to that? No, no, no. How much would we be in love with him? How much would he mean to us if we would? Why does Jesus say, if you'll love me, you'll obey my commands? Because he knows us better than we know ourselves. And he understands when we obey the commandment of God, that we will fall in love with our Heavenly Father. That's what it means to love God. It's costly. My emotion, my will, my desire, it has to be put under the submission of God. I have to obey God. When I obey God, it's not because I'm trying to get God's favor. It's because I love Him. And the more I obey Him, the more I love Him. And the more I love Him, the more I obey Him. And it's this cyclical thing that moves us into a great love relationship with the Father. If you don't love God, try obeying Him. Try putting Him first in your life. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, with everything in you, try saying yes to Him every time and see what doesn't happen to your love for the Father. Amen. Are you enjoying this? Are you getting something out of this? Yeah, we need to be in church, folks. No one can serve two masters, it says in Matthew 6:24. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. That's what it says in 6:24. We talked about that in Matthew. If you want to love God, you must love Him exclusively. No other gods can have any of your attention. Our hearts must be set only on what delights His heart. Our minds must be anchored only on the Word as its final authority. Our souls must be satisfied only with what pleases Him. Our strength must be spent only on God alone. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. If you want to know, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. Why? Why is it the first and why is it the greatest commandment? Why? Because if you love God and you have action toward God and you prefer God at every turn in your life, you will be so in love with Him. So many people come and say, Pastor, I don't feel this affection for God. Okay, I'm not asking you to feel an affection. I'm asking you to have an agape love. I'm asking you to turn your life over to Him. I'm asking you to let your life be completely folded into His desire for you. And when you do that, you will become emotionally attached to the Father. People say, well, how come I don't feel the love towards God? Because you don't do what He says. I mean, let's just be honest. Right? Look, let me ask you a question, mom and dads. You have children, if you're mom and dads. You have children. And when they do what you say, you think they're the greatest kids in the world. Even when they're adults, especially when they're adults, especially when they don't behave all the time. When they don't do what you say, and you know what's coming down the road because you've lived life a little more than they have, when they rebel against you and they rebel against the Word of God, you don't like them very much. You don't feel affection for them. In fact, you get angry. Anybody in here besides me do that? Don't raise your hand. But isn't that the way life goes? Isn't that the way life goes? He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, Jesus says in Matthew 10. In Luke 14, he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father or mother or wife or children or brothers or sisters, yes, even his own life, cannot be my disciple. Nothing can be more important than your deeds toward God. Huh. John 14. He who has my commandments and keeps them. Now listen to this. Now you know why. He who has my commandments and keeps them is the one who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I will love him and will disclose myself to him or her. That's amazing. The God of the universe is saying, love the Lord with all your God, love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind and your strength.
Love the Lord, love him that way. And when you love him that way, Jesus comes and he discloses himself. He reveals himself. He comes and has communication with you. The God of the universe is coming to your house when you love him. People say, well, God just doesn't speak to me. Go back. Go back one step, and before you say God doesn't speak to me, ask this. Do I love him? Do my actions say that I love him? Do I love him with all my heart, with all my mind, with all my soul, with all my strength? Do I love him that way? Do I? Folks, this is not a negative. This is a positive. This is a way for me to shine a light on my life and go, wow, I need to learn how to love God. Because when I love God, guess what? He tells me in his word that he will come to my house. He will come and he will disclose himself to me. He will reveal himself to me. He will show himself to me. I can't wait for Jesus to show himself. I'm so excited about, I'm emotional about that. Wouldn't you be? If God says, look, here's an invitation. Let's play a little game. You do what you love me with all your heart, soul, and mind, and I'll show up at your house. Ready to make that exchange? Anybody want that exchange? Anybody want to play that game? I do. Sign me up. Sign me up. Sign me up. Because I can't wait. Wait for that to happen. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for once he has been approved, he will receive a crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. So no matter what happens in my life, my job is to persevere. My job is to love him with all my heart, my soul, my mind, my strength. My job is to love him like that. And when I persevere, even through things that are tough, guess what? He's got a crown for me. He's got a reward for me. He's going to show up to my house and he's going to reveal himself to me. There will be rejoicing. Look, how many of us need Jesus in our house? He's already there. But if he's there and you don't feel like he's revealing himself to you, I'm just saying, what does the Bible say? Study the scriptures. I'm just saying. Are you learning anything? To love God with all our heart, we must love him exhaustively. Him alone. To love him with all our soul, we must find our satisfaction in him. To love God with all our mind, we must make every decision to obey his command. To love him with all our strength, we must persevere in every trial and keep loving him. That's loving God. That's found from Sheila Hollowine wrote that. I thought that was great. Let me just read, and I'll close with this, one more story. If I can find it, maybe I don't have it. Oops, I didn't bring it, I guess. Oh, here it is. 2 weeks after the stolen steak deal, this is from a book, Dad, the Family Coach. Author is Dave Simmons. The stolen steak deal is his wife would reach over at steak and take a piece of the steak off his plate and would say, love is action, love is action. So you have to love me, you have to give me your steak. So she would steal his steak. So 2 weeks after that, 2 weeks after the stolen steak deal, I took Helen, 8-year-old, Helen was his daughter, and Brandon, 5-year-old, to the Cloverleaf Mall in Hattiesburg to do a little shopping. As we drove up, we spotted a Peterbilt 18-wheeler parked with a big sign on it that says Petting Zoo. The kids jumped up in a rash in a rush and ask, Daddy, Daddy, can we go? Can we go? Please, can we go? Can you just see your kids doing that? Sure, even your 30-year-old kid. Dad, can I go? Can I go? Yeah, sure. Sure, I said, flipping them both a quarter before walking into Sears. Sears, that must be a long time ago because Sears is no longer with us, I don't think. They bolted away, and I felt free to take my time looking for a scroll saw. A petting zoo consists of portable fences erected in the mall with about 6 inches of sawdust and 100 little furry baby animals of all kinds. Kids play, pay their money, and stay in an enclosed entrapment with the squirmy little furry creatures while their moms and dads shop. A few minutes later, I turned around and saw Helen walking along behind me. I was shocked to see she preferred the hardware department to the petting zoo. Recognizing my error, I bent down and asked her what was wrong. She looked up at me with those giant brown eyes and said sadly, "Well, Daddy, it cost 50 cents. So I gave Brandon my quarter." Then she said the most beautiful thing I've ever heard. She repeated the family motto, and the family motto is, "Love is action." So she gave Brandon her quarter, and no one loves cuddly, furry creatures more than Helen. She had watched Sandy take my steak and say, "Love is action." She had watched both of us do and say, "Love is action." For years around the house, the Kings and Kings Arrows Ranch, she had heard and seen, "Love is action." And now she had incorporated into her little life, "Love is action." It had become a part of her. What do you think I did? Well, not what you might think. As soon as I finished my errands, I took Helen to the petting zoo. We stood by the fence and watched Brandon go crazy petting and feeding the animals. Helen stood with her hands and chin resting on the fence, just watching Brandon, just watching him. I had 50 cents burning a hole in my pocket. I never offered it to Helen, and she never asked, because she knew the whole family motto. It's not love is action, it's love is sacrificial. Love is always a price that is paid. Love always costs something. Love is expensive. When you love, benefits accrue on another person's account. Love is for you, not for me. Love gives, it doesn't grab. Helen gave her quarter to Brandon and wanted to follow through with her lesson. She knew she had to taste the sacrifice. She wanted to experience the total family model. Love is sacrificial action. That's what love is. So when it says, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind and your strength, and the other two synoptics, that means that it's an action in my life. I submit to God with everything in me, and God does the rest. Love is action. Do you understand that a little better now? Yeah, I hope so. Let's pray. Father, we didn't even get to the second part of this, love your neighbor as yourself, so Father, help us to understand that. Help these that are here and those online to go and read it and figure out what it means, Lord Jesus. Because in the Gospel of Luke, you tell this wonderful story about the Samaritan. And so, Father, I pray that you would help us to know what it means to love you, to have an action towards you, to obey you, to lay down our life for you, to do what you say and to be what you want us to be, to be those people who are action people. Help us to love you in action. Thank you, God, for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for letting it mean something to us. Lord, I know that you are a God of grace and mercy. I know that we're not saved by any act of our own, but we sure are falling in love with you by our action. And I pray, Lord God, that we would do so. I pray that we would fall in love with you, and love you with all our heart, with all our strength, with all our soul, with all our mind. I pray, God, that we would love you that way. Move in us to do what you call us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go today and love God with all your heart, strength, mind, and soul. Go and love it. And fall in love with him. Be emotional.